We're gonna tie the purple smelt fly pattern. It's an old New Hampshire pattern that was originated by a fly tyer from the Keene, New Hampshire area named Ora Smith. The first step of this is to choose your hook. This is a size 4 and it's 9X. I think for most New Hampshire smelt, this is gonna get you about at the right length of it. What I'm gonna do is I'm gonna start and I'm gonna put some white thread for a base. And the reason we use white thread is we're gonna be putting some floss on this. And if we use the dark color thread underneath the floss, when it gets wet, the floss would change its color. And one of the things that you can see me do every about 10 wraps is I counterclockwise spin my thread and it opens the fibers of the thread up and it results in a really smooth body. The next step I'm gonna do is I'm gonna put on my ribbing and the material for my tag. I take the short end towards the rear of the fly, I sandwich the two gold ends together, I rotate it and I can pull that right up. It locked right into place. And I'm just gonna wrap back on this 2 wraps and then wrap forward a couple quick, maybe 3 wraps. The next part of the fly is the floss body. And the floss body calls for a fluorescent red. Floss I'm using here today is 4 strand. What I wanna do is I wanna just use 2 of the strands. Now one of the things that I'm gonna do, and you'll watch, is as I go up, I'm still gonna spin my thread counterclockwise. And I'm gonna keep that tag end, that waist end, on the underside of the hook. And one of the tricks is you can move right along going up that shank and you're locking everything in at this point. You're locking in the floss and you're locking in the mylar at the same time. And just about, oh, I'd say about 1/8 of an inch from the top, I'm gonna reach in and just snip off the waist. Make sure I got all the little pieces off there. And then I'm just gonna wind it right up. And you can see where I stop here, I've stopped at, you know, maybe a wooden match head's distance back from the eye. It's good to have a landmark like that because it's important to make sure that you don't bring your thread too far forward, because when you try to finish the fly off, you won't have enough room for all the rest of the material. So one of the things that I do is I stroke all this material straight up and it kind of flattens the fibers. And I make my first turn right at the junction of where that tag ended. And then I slowly work my way up. Don't have much waste there, but it's covered that really well. So now I'm gonna rib this. And I wanna kinda rib it up so that I have equal space in my ribs. And usually on a 9X hook like this, we're looking at anywhere between 8 and 11 equal wraps. And then I tie it off. One of the things with bucktail is when you choose the bucktail for the throat, you definitely want to look at the area right in here between my fingers, on either side. Down here, they're very coarse and hollow and kind of thicker. And up at the top, they're really thin, and sometimes they're brittle at the top. So we choose bucktail from this middle area here, and you can see this one's picked pretty good. And then I always change my scissors. I don't use the same scissors to cut coarse material as I do the rest of the fly. I'm gonna kind of cull out any of the small pieces. And then I'm gonna stack these. You can hand stack them. You could kind of line up your tips and do a little maneuvering kind of gymnastics with the hair. But you can achieve the same thing by using a hair stacker. And it's put all the tips right down the bottom. Then what I do is I point the butt end, the bottom end, towards the rear of the fly. That way, when I pull the material out, it's orientated the way I want it. One of the things that you want is you want to use your bucktail. You want this to be really sparse. So what I've done is I've measured this from the tie-in spot, and I want it to come just right where the barb of the hook is. So I cut it off. And then one of the tricks that you can do with bucktail that really can make the bucktail adhere better, the bucktail's hollow. And when you apply it, it likes to compress and it likes to roll on the when you tie it in. So what I just did was took a little bit, a tiny bit of head cement and coated the tips. And it's so sparse that I can actually grab this whole bunch of bucktail with my first wrap. And now you see you've got a nice throat underneath it. It's tapered. So now what I'm gonna do is I'm actually gonna make my move, and I'm gonna tie off with a two-turn whip finish, and I'm gonna switch to black because the head calls for black. So now again, I'm gonna put my black thread on, wind it up, cut off the piece of waste. And now I'm ready to work on my wings. Now the wings are made up of saddle. Saddle comes from a rooster, and we're using a color saddle. This particular saddle right here is from Ewing. It's a lavender color. It's very hard to find lavender. We gotta measure out our wing here. And we want our wing to extend beyond the bend of the hook, and I'm gonna see that that's lined up. It's not sticking out too far. It should be fairly good, and it should result in a streamlined wing. And I pull the fibers away, and then I'm just gonna tear all that material and even them up on both sides. So what I've done is I just kind of reached in with my bodkin, and I pulled away from the side. And then all I'm gonna do with this is gonna trim it off so I have something to work with. The trick with these is I'm gonna take each one of these. I'm gonna use that first one as the template. But I want the tips to be right lined up as close to even as I possibly can. This is a fabric fusion. You get this at the local fabric store. It holds patches on. It fixes little rips in your clothes and different things like that. And what we do is coat the wing just on the stem, a little bit into the fiber and a little bit into the bare stem, and I sandwich them together. Option one is that I can tie all four wings in at once. Option two is I can tie one wing in, one pair of wings in per side, individually. And it often depends. I can lay it up there and get one or two quick wraps on it. Now it's pretty much in place. Then I'm gonna line up the butts so they're all pretty much lined up. And then I'm gonna tie the other two in. So now if you look at that, you can see that looks, it should look like it's close to being one feather all bunched together. And then I'm gonna lock those wings in, and I'm in good shape there. The next part is a cheek. And the cheek on this fly is teal. And teal is really good, because I personally think whenever I am struggling fly fishing in New Hampshire and I'm not getting any action when I'm using a streamer, if I switch to something that has teal, I usually get some results, and it covers the front side of it. It's about probably maybe a third of the distance from the head to the very back of the streamer feathers. Again, I lock these down. For the eyes, we're gonna use this material. It's called a jungle cock or a jungle fowl, whatever you wanna refer to it as. It's a bird that used to be readily available. It's not now. It's hard to find the material. And what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna strip off carefully, because these stems can be a little problematic and can kind of split a little bit on you, and then you don't really get a good tie-in spot. They're not anchored in there very well. So I'm going to set up both of these eyes. This was always done by tires who wanted people to come back and buy their flies. They would adhere the eye to the cheek. And so I'm going to do that with this. I'm just put a little of that fabric fusion on the back side of this eye. And I'm going to lay it right in place. You can see that's right in there nice. And on this one, I kind of run it up the stem. So all those stems are, for the most part, all in line. You could run it so that the eye was on the shank, so it was parallel to the shank. So now I've locked these in. They're in good shape. Now comes down to the process of snipping all the waste off and finishing the head. I try to snip off the pieces in order. Remember, the four initial rods of the saddle hackle, they're tied in pretty good now. So now we get down to the last four rods, and I kind of bend them at 90 degrees, and then I snip them off. And I'm gonna finish this head off. And the way to finish a streamer head is to start up behind the eye and work back. And what you're doing is you're covering everything and you're building a nice bullet-shaped head. And usually with a streamer like this, I want to have a fairly decent size eye. So now I'm going to whip finish. And when I whip finish, I start in the middle and I wind my whip finish towards the eye. And I just wiggle it, make sure it's nice and snug and tight. And then I trim it off. Now, we're gonna finish this off, and traditionally, the tires of the day, they probably use nail polish. And today, a lot of people use head cement or varnish, and it works wonderful. The thing is that the head cement usually takes a couple, three or four good coats to get that nice, shiny head. And one of the things that has hit the market that's really good is these UV resins. And the resins are, they're were originally designed for surfboard companies. Okay, we're just gonna paint it on the thread here. And it's bone dry. It dries very quickly. One coat is all you need. It's basically bulletproof. We use this torch, this UV light, and I get it so that it pulsates. And I just hit this nice and easy, rotate it back and forth. And it's about 20 seconds, and it sets this whole thing up. The head is all solidified right there. And there you have it. You have a nice smelt pattern. You take a look at that. It's got some nice lines with it. You've got the teal with that barring, and then you have your jungle cock eye. You can see your body slightly underneath it. When this gets wet, it's gonna really streamline down, and you're gonna have a nice fly.